The Climate Village Program proclaim it is a national initiative of community-based climate change activities on the local level. Are we aware of the trend that natural disasters are becoming more frequent? Since the last decade, the number of disasters in Indonesia has increased. This trend is dominated by disasters due to climate change and extreme weather events or hydrometeorology such as floods, strong wind, landslide, forest fire, and drought. Factors increasing this trend are mainly environmental damage and a decrease of environmental quality due to human activities. For example, the critical condition at the watershed. Furthermore, population growth, urbanization, spatial planning problems, and unsustainable social behavior that does not reflect environmental awareness. This is worsened by the impacts of climate change caused by global warming. As we know, global warming is a result of increasing greenhouse gas emission driven by various human activities. The Ministry of Environment and Forestry encourages all communities to take an active role, considering individuals and communities are the key actors to reduce the risk of hydrometeorological disasters. One of the Ministry of Environment and Forestry strategies is strengthening community-based climate change adaptation and mitigation capacity in the local level through the implementation of PROCLIM. The Indonesian law asserts that communities obtain the same rights and opportunities in contributing to the management and protection of the environment. The awareness of communities on climate change and its impact, which can threaten various aspects of life, needs to be increased. PROCLIM enhances the active role of communities to respond to climate change impact and adopt low carbon emission lifestyle. PROCLIM can be developed by community groups, village, traditional village, and it can be also established by communities at other specific area that have been implementing sustainable adaptation and mitigation actions, such as college, boarding schools, and parishes. How is PROCLIM implemented? PROCLIM can be implemented by existing community groups in an area. They play a role as a working group. This working group identifies the vulnerability, risk, and climate change impacts, as well as the sources of greenhouse gases emissions. The results from this initial identification exercise are incorporated into the vulnerability and greenhouse gases emission profile. Thereafter, the working group identifies the availability of human resources and the capacity building needs. Furthermore, the working group develops a plan to improve community capacity. Together with the working group, communities define the targets to be achieved to respond to the impacts of climate change. All the inputs and ideas are used to develop a climate change adaptation and mitigation actions plan, as well as actions to strengthen institutions and sustainability aspects. The next step is to plan climate change adaptation activities. For example, controlling drought, floods and landslide by constructing rainwater storage, biopores and infiltration wells. Other activities are water saving, constructing or modifying building construction to be adaptive to climate change, flood control facilities, enhance food resiliency by applying sequential planting pattern system, crops diversity, and integrated agriculture, irrigation management, and by utilizing the yard for diverse function. For example, growing vegetables and medicinal plants, building fish ponds, etc. Climate-related disease control is strengthened by controlling disease factors, activate the roles of the mosquito larva monitoring personnel, and preventing dengue transmission, as well as adopting healthy lifestyle, improving sanitation, and clean water supply. Climate change mitigation action planning through solid waste and wastewater management.
Recording in progress.
Usage of renewable energy. Energy consumption. innovation and saving, low-emission agriculture, the increase of vegetation cover, the prevention of management of forest and land fires, planning of climate change adaptation and mitigation in the coastal areas, prevention of sea level rise, coastal floods, intrusions, abrasion, ablation, wind erosions, and high reefs. Further activities are the development of natural or artificial protection structures and alternative sustainable livelihoods. The next step is the implementation of the actions plan. Action plans are implemented by prioritizing activities that contribute most to the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions or reduce the most critical impacts of climate change. Brooklyn is an initiative to promote sustainable community-based activity. Thereby, institutional strengthening is the key of success. Community groups in the Brooklyn location are the spearhead in implementing climate change adaptation and mitigation activities at the local level. By implementing sustainable activities, Brooklyn may provide economic, social, environmental benefits and contributes to the reduction of risk caused by climate change. With Brooklyn, we can create a new generation that cares about climate change for our children and grandchildren, for a sustainable life on Earth. Let's move together. With Brooklyn, let's implement adaptation and mitigation activities.
Perubahan iklim adalah perubahan komposisi atmosfer secara global akibat aktivitas manusia, baik langsung maupun tidak langsung. Alih guna lahan dan penggunaan bahan bakar fosil pada aktivitas industri, transportasi, energi, dan lain-lain dapat meningkatkan konsentrasi gas rumah kaca, menyebabkan terperangkapnya energi atau panas di atmosfer. Akibatnya, bumi semakin panas, es di kutub mencair, permukaan laut naik, mengancam kawasan pesisir dan dapat menenggelamkan pulau kecil. Selama satu dekade terakhir, tren bencana meningkat. Lebih dari 90% merupakan bencana terkait cuaca dan iklim. Perubahan iklim berdampak hampir di semua bidang kehidupan manusia. Sektor pertanian rentan terhadap perubahan iklim karena dipengaruhi pola tanam, waktu tanam, hama dan penyakit, sehingga dapat menurunkan produksi. Pada tahun 2030, diperkirakan produktivitas tanaman padi akan menurun 0,18 hingga 1,26%. Indonesia, sebagai negara kepulauan, memiliki sekitar 17.000 pulau besar dan kecil. Sangat rentan terhadap abrasi pantai dan rob. Perubahan iklim berdampak pada ketidakpastian nelayan untuk melaut, berpengaruh pada sebaran ikan, dan hasil tangkapan ikan di laut. Perubahan iklim juga berdampak pada kesehatan. Variabilitas dan perubahan iklim berpotensi memperluas habitat vektor dan hewan pembawa penyakit. Kekeringan mengancam ketersediaan sumber daya paling berharga bagi kehidupan, air. Kita harus menyesuaikan diri, namun sumber daya kita terbatas. Adaptasi perubahan iklim dilakukan pada lokasi rentan dan berisiko dengan pilihan aksi yang tepat. Untuk menentukannya, diperlukan kajian kerentanan, risiko, dan dampak perubahan iklim. Tingkat kerentanan dipengaruhi oleh keterpaparan, sensitivitas, dan kapasitas adaptasi. Keterpaparan. Keluarga yang tinggal di bantaran sungai akan lebih mudah terpapar bahaya banjir bila dibandingkan dengan yang tinggal jauh dari sana. Wilayah pesisir lebih mudah terpapar kenaikan permukaan air laut. Sensitivitas. Wilayah yang sebagian besar penduduknya bertani lahan tada hujan akan lebih sensitif pada perubahan iklim dibandingkan wilayah berpenduduk dengan sumber mata pencaharian yang lebih beragam. Kelompok rentan, yaitu anak-anak, perempuan, lanjut usia, dan penyandang disabilitas lebih sensitif terhadap kejadian bencana. Kapasitas adaptasi. Kemampuan suatu individu atau sistem untuk menyesuaikan diri terhadap perubahan. Indikator yang digunakan umumnya terkait dengan akses terhadap berbagai fasilitas dan infrastruktur. seperti pendidikan, fasilitas kesehatan, dan infrastruktur untuk mengantisipasi bencana. Apabila suatu sistem terpapar, sensitif, dan tidak punya kapasitas memadai untuk menyesuaikan diri, maka sistem tersebut dikatakan rentan. Bila suatu wilayah rentan dan peluang terjadinya bahaya perubahan iklim tinggi, maka wilayah tersebut memiliki risiko tinggi. SIDIC atau Sistem Informasi Data Indeks Kerentanan dikembangkan berdasarkan konsep kerentanan dan risiko perubahan iklim tersebut. Saat ini, SIDIC menggunakan variabel data sosial ekonomi, demografi, geografi, dan lingkungan infrastruktur dari PODES atau potensi desa yang dikeluarkan oleh BPS atau Badan Pusat Statistik. SIDIC merupakan sistem data dan informasi berbasis web atau online mengenai tingkat kerentanan suatu wilayah dengan unit analisis hingga level desa. Tingkat kerentanan diukur dengan dua nilai indeks, indeks keterpaparan dan sensitivitas, dan indeks kapasitas adaptasi. Wilayah dengan nilai IKS tinggi, sedangkan nilai IKA rendah, akan mempunyai tingkat kerentanan sangat tinggi. Sebaliknya, bila nilai IKA tinggi dan IKS rendah, maka tingkat kerentanannya rendah. Faktor penyebab kerentanan disajikan dalam bentuk diagram jaring laba-laba. Untuk memudahkan membaca hasilnya, SIDIC menampilkannya dalam bentuk peta dengan pewarnaan yang berbeda untuk tiap kelas kerentanan. SIDIC dapat digunakan untuk menentukan prioritas lokasi dan adaptasi perubahan iklim agar menjadi lebih tepat sasaran dan terintegrasi. Juga untuk merancang dan menggunakan alokasi anggaran agar tepat aksi dan tepat lokasi. Dengan kata lain, SIDIC membantu pemerintah dalam menyusun rencana aksi adaptasi perubahan iklim. SIDIC menggunakan 21 indikator nasional untuk mengukur tingkat kerentanan. Namun, pengguna dimungkinkan untuk menambah indikator dan data yang dimiliki untuk meningkatkan akurasi hasil sesuai karakteristik wilayah. Kedepan, SIDIC akan terus ditingkatkan agar mampu melakukan analisis secara spasial dan terintegrasi dengan sektor pembangunan.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Yang terhormat Menteri Lingkungan Hidup dan Kehutanan, yang kami hormati Menteri Koordinator Bidang Kemaritiman dan Investasi, Utusan Presiden Amerika Serikat dalam Penanganan Perubahan Iklim, Kepala Perwakilan Bank Dunia untuk Indonesia dan Timor Leste, para penasehat senior Menteri Lingkungan Hidup dan Kehutanan, para tenaga ahli Menteri Lingkungan Hidup dan Kehutanan, para pejabat eselon 1 lingkup Kementerian Kehutanan, serta para undangan yang telah hadir di tempat ini maupun yang telah berkenan hadir secara virtual pada acara ini. Selamat pagi dan salam sejahtera. Dalam rangka outreach implementasi kebijakan perubahan iklim dan pelibatan para pihak dalam upaya pengendalian perubahan iklim, maka pada hari ini, Senin tanggal 18 Oktober 2021, akan dilaksanakan acara Climate Leaders Messenger yang menampilkan 4 pimpinan kementerian atau lembaga dunia yang akan menyampaikan pesan-pesan terkait perubahan iklim. Antara lain, pertama, Ibu Siti Nurbaya, Menteri Lingkungan Hidup dan Kehutanan. Kedua, Bapak Luhut Binsar Panjaitan, selaku Menteri Koordinator Kemaritiman dan Investasi. Ketiga, Bapak John F. Kerry, selaku Utusan Presiden Amerika Serikat dalam penanganan perubahan iklim. Dan empat, Ibu Satu Kahkonen, Kepala Perwakilan Bank Dunia untuk Indonesia dan Timor Leste. Hadirin yang kami hormati, dengan mengucap bismillahirrahmanirrahim, acara pagi ini akan kita mulai dengan bersama-sama mendengarkan pesan-pesan terkait perubahan iklim dari Menteri Lingkungan Hidup dan Kehutanan. Kepada Ibu Siti Nurbaya, kami silakan.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom Om Swastiastu. Selamat pagi seluruh peserta Festival Iklim 2021 yang saya cintai. Hari ini kita beruntung, saya minta maaf pagi-pagi ini kita lakukan karena hari ini kita mendapatkan kesempatan untuk menerima, mendengarkan catatan dari climate leaders, para pemimpin dalam rangka perubahan iklim, yaitu yang terhormat Bapak Menko Maritim dan Investasi, kemudian Bapak John Kerry, United States Special President Envoy untuk Climate, dan juga ada Ibu Satu Kakonen sebagai Country Director World Bank untuk Indonesia. Mengapa ini bisa kita lakukan? Kita bersyukur dan berterima kasih selain kepada Tuhan Yang Maha Esa, tentu karena pada kesempatan ini yang terhormat Bapak Menko Maritim dan Investasi, Bapak Luhut Binsar Panjaitan berkesempatan untuk berdiskusi dengan Excellency Mr. John Kerry sebagai US Special Envoy untuk Presiden untuk iklim di Amerika Serikat. Jadi pagi ini, kalau kita pagi di sana malam gitu ya. Mereka baru saja bertemu dan Pak Menko juga didampingi oleh Pak Wamen Aludohong dan juga ada Menteri Kesehatan. Kita akan mendapatkan pesan dari leaders dalam climate dan kita sudah kenal siapa Pak John Kerry dan tentu saja kita juga mengenal bagaimana peran dari World Bank untuk berbagai pembangunan dan concern serta perhatiannya kepada perubahan iklim. Sebelumnya saya juga ingin menyampaikan beberapa pesan penting untuk perubahan iklim bagi kita semua. Besok kita akan mengakhiri festival iklim ini dan tentu catatan yang lebih luas akan saya sampaikan besok. Tetapi bahwa intinya kita melakukan seluruh pekerjaan dalam kaitan dengan perubahan iklim ini seperti yang ditampilkan di dalam festival iklim ini. Saya berterima kasih kepada semua pemangku kepentingan dan khususnya generasi muda. Jadi kita sudah menyadari bersama apa yang menjadi tantangan. Demikian pula kita juga sudah tahu karena kita sudah 2 minggu ini dan menjelang akhir untuk roadmap, yaitu berbagai dokumen-dokumen NDC, kemudian roadmap mitigasi, roadmap adaptasi, dan lain-lain. Dan tahun ini pada tanggal 22 Juli juga sudah kita update untuk NDC kita, memang masih 41% apabila dengan dukungan kerjasama teknik internasional dan finansial tentu saja, dan masih di angka 29% apabila kita bicara dengan kekuatan kita sendiri. Tetapi yang penting dari dokumen yang kita serahkan itu juga didampingi dengan long term strategy. Di situ menunjukkan bagaimana kita berambisi untuk mengatasi atau untuk melangkah di dalam mengatasi perubahan iklim di Indonesia kita. Di dalam proses ini penting karena menjelang COP26 itu ada pada posisi di mana titik implementasi akan dimulai. Oleh karena itu menjadi tegas bahwa kita bekerja, kita mengimplementasikan. Jadi bukan basa-basi, bukan narasi, bukan hanya deklarasi. Jadi itu yang paling penting, nyata, konkret. Dan contohnya nanti Volu Net Sync dengan berbagai kegiatan, kebijakan, dan antisipasi berbagai persoalan, partisipasi semua pihak di dalam semua agenda kehutanan seperti kebakaran hutan, deforestasi, gambut, konservasi, biodiversity, semuanya. Itu kita sudah 6-7 tahun ini bekerja keras dan kita akan sistematikakan dengan lebih baik lagi untuk mencapai, menjaga pengendalian perubahan iklim kita. Jadi kita akan mendengarkan dan saya kira ini sangat penting untuk kita semua. Saya minta maaf ini dalam rekaman karena saya mendampingi Bapak Presiden pada agenda-agenda di lapangan. Saya ingin menyampaikan ucapan selamat dan terima kasih atas partisipasi semua pihak khususnya generasi muda. Demikian, wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom, Om Santi, 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 Om.
Udah. Ya, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Yang saya hormati Ibu Siti Nurbaya, Menteri Lingkungan Hidup dan Kehutanan, His Excellency Secretary John Kerry, His Excellency Ibu Satu Kahkonen, Country Director World Bank for Indonesia dan Timor Leste, seluruh narasumber dan peserta Festival Iklim yang saya banggakan. Saya menyampaikan apresiasi atas inisiatif Kementerian Lingkungan Hidup dan Kehutanan yang menyelenggarakan Indonesia Climate Festival Week 2021. Hal ini sangat mulia karena bertujuan untuk meningkatkan kesadaran masyarakat, khususnya di kalangan generasi muda, dan memotivasi para pemangku kepentingan untuk mengambil tindakan nyata untuk mengatasi dampak buruk dari perubahan iklim. Dampak perubahan iklim sangat nyata di hadapan kita, dan COVID-19 dan resesi global semakin memperumit situasi semua ini. Kondisi COVID-19 di Indonesia mulai beberapa waktu yang lalu sudah mulai membaik, dan kalau kita lihat reproduksi efektif daripada COVID Indonesia sudah di bawah 0,98 dan di beberapa tempat sudah ada 0,97. Jadi semua menunjukkan perbaikan-perbaikan yang sangat signifikan kalau kita bandingkan kepada waktu-waktu yang lalu. Jakarta sendiri sekarang sudah berada pada 0,95 reproduksinya. Nah, menyangkut kepada perubahan iklim, Indonesia itu sangat serius mengendalikan perubahan iklim. Saya barusan selesai makan malam dengan utusan khusus Presiden Biden, John Kerry, bersama-sama Pak Alu, Ibu Nani, dan kita membicarakan panjang lebar sekali tadi bagaimana program untuk mengarah ke situ. Nah, saya sampaikan Indonesia sangat serius untuk pengendalian perubahan iklim sebagai negara kepulauan terbesar dan pemilik hutan tropis. Penanggulangan perubahan iklim merupakan kepentingan nasional melalui langkah-langkah kebijakan, pemberdayaan, dan penegakan hukum. Laju defrostrasi juga saya jelaskan bahwa kita dalam beberapa tahun terakhir ini punya prestasi yang sangat baik. Nah, itu juga mereka akui. Dan pencegahan konversi hutan alam dan lahan gambut hingga 62,6 juta hektar, pengurangan kebakaran hutan sebesar 82%, sedangkan di beberapa wilayah Amerika, Australia, dan Eropa mengalami peningkatan terbesar. Solusi iklim tidak hanya datang dari ruang konferensi yang hadiri wakil pemerintah dan seluruh dunia. Setiap orang memiliki peran dan untuk dimainkan dalam memerangi perubahan iklim. Seperti halnya pemuda yang memiliki karakter idealis, inovatif, connected everywhere. Pemuda perlu menjadi solusi. Pemuda mainkan peran penting dalam memerangi perubahan iklim. Pemuda mudah beradaptasi dan dapat dengan cepat menjadikan gaya hidup rendah karbon dan pilihan karir sebagai bagian dari kehidupan sehari-hari mereka. Oleh karena itu, pemuda harus diberi kesempatan berperan aktif dalam pengambilan keputusan di tingkat lokal, nasional, dan global. Penanganan perubahan iklim tidak bisa dilakukan oleh pemerintah sendiri. Kerjasama dan antara peran dan keterlibatan kementerian lembaga hidup, lembaga kementerian dan lembaga, dunia usaha, dan swasta, pemerintah daerah, dan LSM, masyarakat, bahkan media asing memegang peranan penting dalam hal ini. Indonesia telah memperbaharui NDC yang meningkatkan kapasitas adaptasi dan ketahanan iklim. Indonesia yang berpartisipasi aktif dalam kerangka konvensi perubahan iklim ke-26 diadakan di Inggris untuk mendukung capaian hasil yang diharapkan. Indonesia juga menyambut baik target sejumlah negara maju net zero emission pada tahun abad ini. Terlepas dari momentum pandemi COVID-19, kami mengajak para pemangku kepentingan untuk mencapai tujuan dan target update NDC melalui visi long-term strategi low carbon dan climate resilience 2050. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, kami berharap melalui pesan disampaikan dalam tema Festival Iklim ini, pemerintah Indonesia mendorong semua pemangku kepentingan untuk mengambil bagian dalam aksi iklim untuk bersama-sama mencapai target pengurangan emisi dan pembangunan ketahanan iklim di seluruh negeri, menuju Indonesia yang tangguh dan terus berkembang. Dan ini harapan saya, supaya anak-anak muda semua itu kalian betul-betul bisa berkarya dalam masalah lingkungan hidup ini. Karena ini masalah yang serius. Dulu waktu zaman saya, ini tidak dianggap terlalu penting. Sekarang tidak bisa diabaikan bahwa masalah climate change ini menjadi sangat penting. Selamat bertugas, selamat bekerja. Sekian, terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Hello, and thank you, Minister Sidi, for this opportunity to be part of Indonesia's Climate Festival Week. We are speaking at a critical time for Indonesia and for the planet, with 2 weeks to go until the world leaders meet in Glasgow for COP26. Our mission for Glasgow should be to do everything possible to keep a 1.5 degrees Celsius limit on temperature rise and to keep it within reach, to make the 2020s a decade of action. As a major and rapidly growing economy, a G20 country, and a country blessed with some of the richest biodiversity in the world, what happens in Indonesia matters immensely to the whole world. As the world's fourth largest emitter of greenhouse gases and a nation of islands surrounded by water, Indonesia is both a contributor and a victim to the global climate crisis. Under the leadership of President Jokowi and Minister Sidi, Indonesia has made tremendous progress in halting deforestation and building on the moratorium on the conversion of primary forests. And I know how hard Indonesia has worked to make a solid contribution in Glasgow. Between 2019 and 2020, Indonesia saw deforestation fall to its lowest rates in 20 years. New initiatives are also underway to restore hundreds of thousands of hectares of degraded mangroves over the next 4 years. And that work is critical, and we all look forward to its success. I've been working very closely with your officials this year to build our collaboration on fighting the climate crisis. And President Jokowi was among one of the heads of states invited to participate in the virtual major economies forum that was hosted by President Biden this September. During that conference, we discussed the best way to galvanize cooperation for major countries in order to achieve ambitious concrete steps to realize the targets for emissions reductions ahead of COP26 summit in November. We also applaud Indonesia's announcement during the Major Economies Forum that it plans to join the US-EU Global Methane Pledge that will officially launch at COP26. It's actions like this that will help to shine a spotlight on Indonesia's climate leadership. However, we all know an awful lot of work remains if we're going to avoid the most catastrophic scenarios that are outlined in the IPCC report. The world needs to cut emissions by at least 45% by 2030 in order to be on a credible path to net zero by 2050. If we don't reduce enough in 2020 to 2030, we can't achieve net zero 2050, and we can't keep 1.5 degree limit on the warming of the planet. I've just finished a meeting here in Washington with Coordinating Minister Lahoute and Vice Minister for Environment and Forest, Alu Dohong. And there we discussed Indonesia's climate ambitions and its potential to be a regional and global leader on climate. With roughly 2 weeks left before COP26, my friends, the time to act is now. There is no more room for delay. I also want to address my message today, especially to the younger generation that are participating and watching this climate festival. The world is home now to 1.8 billion young people between the ages of 10 to 24, the largest generation of youth in history. In Indonesia, 65 million people, or 28% of the population, falls into this age group. Young people are well aware of the challenges and opportunities that are presented by the climate crisis. And your unprecedented mobilization around the world shows the massive power that you possess to hold decision makers accountable. I'm very hopeful for the future of Indonesia and for our planet, because you're ready to work and the time to act, we all know, is now. Let's get started. Thank you.
Your Excellency, Pak Lahoute, Coordinating Minister for Maritime Affairs and Investment. Your Excellency, Ibu Siti, Minister for Environment and Forestry. Your Excellency, John Kerry, the United States Special Presidential Envoy for Climate. Ladies and gentlemen, selamat pagi. It's my great pleasure to be with you this morning and talk about the challenge of our times, climate change. By 2050, climate change can force over 250 million people to move within their own country. And in the next 10 years, it can force over 150 million people into poverty. Indonesia ranks among the top third of countries in the world for climate risk. This beautiful country faces a high exposure to flooding, extreme heat, and rising sea levels. And unless action is taken, Indonesia's climate risks will continue to intensify and hit the poorest the hardest, leading to significant economic costs estimated at 2.5 to 7% of GDP. That is massive. This means that no action is not an option. There are no winners if we continue business as usual, only losers. Global emissions need to be reduced now if we are to avoid the worst impacts of climate change. This will take significant multilateral collaboration across all countries and also finance. And we all need to do our part. Governments, the private sector, communities, households, individuals. This is our shared global challenge. With the second longest coastline in the world and one of Earth's most biologically diverse landscapes, Indonesia is well positioned to lead the mitigation and adaptation agenda. The World Bank applauds the government of Indonesia for its efforts so far. We are particularly encouraged by the ambitious target to achieve carbon neutrality in the forest and land use sector by 2030, and by Indonesia's commitment to the world's largest mangrove rehabilitation program, with the aim to rehabilitate 600,000 hectares of mangroves in 4 years. This is important because mangroves are a big carbon sink. We welcome the recent adoption of a carbon tax and look forward to the presidential decree, which will enable further adoption of other carbon pricing instruments, such as the emission trading scheme. The government has also established a moratorium for new coal-fired power plants as of 2023 and announced a schedule for closure of all coal-fired power plants by 2050, and with that, a shift to renewable energy. These are all important actions, and we need to take a note of them. With the support of $83 billion in the past 4 years, the World Bank is the largest multilateral funder of climate investments in developing countries. In Indonesia, we actively support government's efforts to transition to a low-carbon economy through technical assistance, support, and investments. These activities include clean energy, promoting sustainable landscape management, including mangroves rehabilitation, sustainable oceans management, and climate finance mobilization. We are working closely with the Ministry of Environment and Forestry to pay for the forest conservation and reduction in greenhouse gas emissions in East Kalimantan. What Indonesia has already achieved there could result in the largest emission reduction payment in the whole world. Mitigating impacts of climate change is not easy. However, with cooperation from all of us, it is possible. So let's continue working together to save the beauty of Indonesia and to save our planet. Terima kasih banyak.
Kami ucapkan terima kasih kepada Ibu Siti Nurbaya, Bapak Luhut Binsar Panjaitan, Bapak John F. Kerry, dan Ibu Satu Kahkonen yang telah memberikan pesan-pesan terkait perubahan iklim pada hari ini. Hadirin yang kami hormati, kami mohon perhatiannya atas hal-hal berikut ini. Pertama, setelah acara ini selesai, nanti akan dilaksanakan fokus group discussion tentang kerangka transparansi untuk memperkuat inventarisasi gas rumah kaca nasional dan mendukung Indonesia LTS LCCR 2050. Dan ini merupakan rangkaian acara dari Festival IKIM 2021. Bapak-bapak dan ibu-ibu dapat mengikuti acara ini pada link bit.ly FI21FGDMAP. Kedua, pada pukul 15 sampai dengan 16.30 waktu Indonesia Barat akan dilaksanakan talk show tentang teknologi modifikasi cuaca dan pengapatan tinggi muka air tanah. Dan pada pukul 16.30 nanti akan dilaksanakan kembali Climate Leaders Message sesi kedua yang akan menampilkan tiga pimpinan kementerian dan lembaga. Pertama, Ibu Laksmi Dewanti selaku National Focal Point UNFCCC Indonesia. Kedua, Bapak Joseph Borrell selaku Wakil Presiden Uni Eropa. Dan ketiga, Bapak Norimasa Shimamura selaku Ketua Perwakilan UNDP Indonesia. Hadirin yang kami hormati, dengan selesainya ini, maka kita sampai di ujung acara. Akhir kata, kami mengucapkan terima kasih atas perhatiannya dan mohon maaf atas kekurangan pada penyelenggaraannya. Wabillahi taufik wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. mengingatkan kepada Bapak dan Ibu, kami mengundang Bapak-Bapak dan Ibu itu untuk mengikuti ketiga kegiatan tersebut pada link YouTube Kementerian LHK atau pada YouTube Ditjen PPI. Terima kasih.
The Climate Village Program proclaim. It is a national initiative of community-based climate change activities on the local level. Are we aware of the trend that natural disasters are becoming more frequent? Since the last decade, the number of disasters in Indonesia has increased. This trend is dominated by disasters due to climate change and extreme weather events or hydrometeorology such as floods, strong wind, landslide, forest fire, and drought. Factors increasing this trend are mainly environmental damage and a decrease of environmental quality due to human activities. For example, the critical condition at the watershed. Furthermore, population growth, urbanization, spatial planning problems, and unsustainable social behavior that does not reflect environmental awareness. This is worsened by the impacts of climate change caused by global warming. As we know, global warming is a result of increasing greenhouse gas emission driven by various human activities. The Ministry of Environment and Forestry encourages all communities to take an active role, considering individuals and communities are the key actors to reduce the risk of hydrometeorological disasters. One of the Ministry of Environment and Forestry strategies is strengthening community-based climate change adaptation and mitigation capacity in the local level through the implementation of PROCLIM. The Indonesian law asserts that communities obtain the same rights and opportunities in contributing to the management and protection of the environment. The awareness of communities on climate change and its impact, which can threaten various aspects of life, needs to be increased. PROCLIM enhances the active role of communities to respond to climate change impact and adopt low carbon emission lifestyle. PROCLIM can be developed by community groups, village, traditional village, and it can be also established by communities at other specific areas that have been implementing sustainable adaptation and mitigation actions, such as college, boarding schools, and parishes. How is PROCLIM implemented? PROCLIM can be implemented by existing community groups in an area. They play a role as a working group. This working group identifies the vulnerability, risk, and climate change impacts, as well as the sources of greenhouse gases emissions. The results from this initial identification exercise are incorporated into the vulnerability and greenhouse gases emission profile. Thereafter, the working group identifies the availability of human resources and the capacity building needs. Furthermore, the working group develops a plan to improve community capacity. Together with the working group, communities define the targets to be achieved to respond to the impacts of climate change. All the inputs and ideas are used to develop a climate change adaptation and mitigation actions plan, as well as actions to strengthen institutions and sustainability aspects activities. For example, controlling drought, floods and landslide by constructing rainwater storage, biopores and infiltration wells. Other activities are water saving, constructing or modifying building construction to be adaptive to climate change, flood control facilities, enhance food resiliency by applying sequential planting pattern system, crops diversity, and integrated agriculture, irrigation management, and by utilizing the yard for diverse function. For example, growing vegetables and medicinal plants, building fish ponds, etc. Climate-related disease control is strengthened by controlling disease factors, activate the roles of the mosquito larva monitoring personnel, and preventing dengue transmission, as well as adopting healthy lifestyle, improving sanitation, and clean water supply. Climate change mitigation action planning through solid waste and wastewater management, usage of renewable energy, energy conservation and saving, low-emission agriculture, the increase of vegetation cover, the prevention of management of forests and land fires, planning of climate change adaptation and mitigation in the coastal areas, prevention of sea level rise, coastal floods, intrusions, abrasion, ablation, wind erosions, and high waves. Further activities are the development of natural or artificial protection structures and alternative sustainable livelihoods. The next step is the implementation of the actions plan. Action plans are implemented by prioritizing activities that contribute most to the reduction of greenhouse gas emission or reduce the most critical impacts of climate change. Brooklyn is an initiative to promote sustainable community-based activity. Thereby, institutional strengthening is the key of success. Community groups in the Brooklyn location are the spearhead in implementing climate change adaptation and mitigation activities at the local level. By implementing sustainable activities, Brooklyn may provide economic, social, environmental benefits and contributes to the reduction of risk caused by climate change. With Brooklyn, we can create a new generation that cares about climate change for our children and grandchildren, for a sustainable life on Earth. Let's move together. With Brooklyn, let's implement adaptation and mitigation activities.